It's my great pleasure now to introduce Dr. Sean Mackey. I also had the pleasure of introducing him 2 years ago when he was in Buenos Aires. And 2 years ago, he told us about his upcoming study where he was trying to predict the patients that were going to develop chronic post-surgical pain. And so here he is 2 years later to give us the latest on his study. And as you know, he is the chief in the division of pain medicine at Stanford University, and he's also the developing professor at Stanford University. So, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you. Dan, thank you for the invitation. Very much appreciated. As was mentioned, I was here, I was in Buenos Aires with you 2 years ago, where we gave a little tantalizing view of where we were going with addressing perioperative pain using a platform that we've developed. You said that I've done this, and the truth is this is the epitome of a team effort in every definition. I'm usually known more as a brain guy. I do a lot of neuroimaging for a living. But and these are my disclosures. Let me get these out of the way. No industry conflicts. But I've been driven for the last 15 to 16 years by these two basic questions. How do we really know if we're making a patient better? And how do we know whether a certain treatment is better for one patient than for another? And most of this was driven by the following events. One is I came on faculty in my chair. Ron Pearl came on as a chair. He no longer looks like a 1970s porn star. He's a very distinguished gentleman. He asked me this simple question: how do you know if your patients are getting any better? He's an intensive care doc. He knows his patients are getting better because they're surviving the ICU. And I said, well, they give me these nice fruitcakes around the holiday, and I get these bottles of wine. He said, how do you really know? And I didn't. And it put me on this journey of trying to figure out. My son, who was born at Stanford, who I brought into the clinic for a year-to-year basis, said, that's unacceptable. We have to find better ways. Unfortunately, Dan Carr came along, and he basically saved us from this because he invented TOPS, which we used for about 8 years in our clinic to capture data. It gave me a great learning experience of how to collect data and what was working and what we needed to do to really improve these systems. And converging on these lines came about 10 years later. These IOM reports, one of which I was on the IOM Pain Committee, which we called for more consistent data, the other one being the National Pain Strategy, which Dan and I were both on, in which we simply said we need better data. And then the IOM Learning Healthcare Series. If you guys want to know about collecting quality data and putting it to use, read this 12-part series on the learning healthcare system. It's a great read, and it is where the future is going. It's going to combine informatics, science, incentives, and culture to align for continuous quality improvement, innovation, and research. That is what prompted us to develop CHOIR. Starting about 6 years ago, we were very quiet about it. We did the very non-sexy, heavy lifting just to build an informatics platform that is open source, open standard, and free. My favorite four-letter F word. It's serving as a treatment registry and as a platform for a learning healthcare system, which we use for point-of-care decision-making, software-based decision-making, risk and treatment stratification, longitudinal outcomes. It's going to be moving into pragmatic trial designs, and then we get a very deep, comprehensive quality assessment, physical, psychological, and social functioning. We've built in a local computer adaptive testing engine using modern educational theory. We've leveraged a lot of the NIH PROMIS metrics, which if you're not familiar with PROMIS and you do patient-reported outcomes, you want to read about PROMIS because it gives you a standardized metric across the entire planet that you can compare your patients. The vision of this is to turn all of our clinics into research labs, where every single patient, every single clinical encounter is deeply characterized and we learn from it. And that learning then helps guide future risk and treatment stratification. The quick features of this, we work real hard to make it easy to use for the patient, the clinician, the staff members. We integrated it into the clinical workflow, and we'll come back to that. We did point of care reporting. We collected over 15,000 patients and quite a few longitudinal data assessments. We've now got this running in multiple national, and it's going into international academic sites. Rob Hurley, who runs pain at Medical College of Wisconsin, put this in both the University of Florida as well as Medical College of Wisconsin. What I think took me most by surprise is it's fundamentally changed the culture of how we care for patients. Because at the end of the day, without quality data, we're all just a bunch of doctors with opinions. I mean, that's the reality. We worked hard to develop added value. Dr. Cao built something called CHOIR Provider, which is automatic note generation. We built opioid risk mitigation tools and opioid tapering tools for those who want to taper their patients down. I get asked questions all the time about why not use REDCap or why not use Epic for this? And this illustration, I hope, brings this across, because each of those products, which are really good for what they do, fill certain niches. REDCap sits at this boundary if you're doing a clinical trial between patient-reported outcomes and clinical outcomes. Epic, if you're dealing with administrative data, billing, scheduling data, and some clinical outcomes, but it doesn't do patient-reported outcomes well at all. CHOIR connects all of those pieces together and fills a much-needed niche. Dr. Darnell, I think, very eloquently talked about the problem of catastrophizing. And so this is just one of several papers that have now been published. This one's actually in a second review, so I'm giving you just a peek at it. She's had a strong interest in sex differences around opioids as well as catastrophizing. This simple question, are men and women different? Well, of course they are. But how are they different when it comes to the use of opioids or the prescribing of opioids? And this heat map shows that if you're a man, you're more likely to prescribe an opioid if you have high pain intensity. If you're a woman, it's because of high pain catastrophizing. The really cool slide is this one, where she was alluding to this earlier, and I'm just showing you the data. By using very large numbers of highly phenotyped data, you can start using sophisticated analytical tools that go beyond standard linear modeling. This one using a general additive model, which allows us to map curves to this high density data. And it allows us to tease apart these subtle effects that might otherwise be lost with standard linear modeling. We usually pay attention to catastrophizing out here. This is what's considered clinically significant. But what this is telling us is that this range, this subclinical range here, is incredibly important in determining whether somebody is going to be prescribed an opioid. And we usually ignore that. And maybe we shouldn't. And this gets back to what Dr. Darnell was talking about with her intervention. I talked briefly last time, and we've now published several more papers on this aspect of characterizing patients before surgery to determine the likelihood of their having persistent pain or persistent opioid use. And this is Dr. Ian Carroll and Gianna Hawes leading this effort through some NIHK grants. And I'm going to show you a model that we've been putting forward now, which looks at the continuum of pain in a somewhat different way. It's recognizing that maybe we shouldn't be looking at things from a pain intensity standpoint or how much opioids people are on, but how long they have pain. And this represents, as a model, four different patients, four different people who may have their pain go away or stop using opioids at different times. You've got Jim, whose pain goes away really, really fast. Sue and Jill in the middle, and Billy Bob out here, who a long time out is still having pain or still using opioids. And what this allows you to do is to develop natural survival curves and use as a means Cox proportional hazard ratio models to be able to determine the factors that cause pain to become persistent. And so we did this, characterizing 700 patients over about 7 years. About 100 patients a year is what we got. And what we found in using Cox proportional hazard ratios is that the factors that tend to predict pain after surgery, it is, by the way, pain on post-op day one has the biggest prediction, but then also the anxiety sensitivity index has a very high hazard ratio, self-perceived risk of addiction, and then if it is breast cancer, we found that pain catastrophizing once again comes up. If it's persistent opioid use after surgery, we find actually somewhat different predictors. It is mainly depression plays some of the biggest role. Every 10-point increase on the Beck depression industry leads to a 40% delay in your likelihood of coming off of an opioid. And we've gone and done a factor analysis and determined it's actually a certain self-loathing characteristic of depression is playing a big role. We then just recently took this into national databases to try to verify this. Eric Sun ran this. This just came out in JAMA Internal Medicine, finding that on this bottom row is the incidence of chronic pain after surgery, excuse me, the incidence of chronic opioids after surgery. All these other surgeries show the increased incidence that occurs, meaning that going into surgery conveys a big risk alone of having persistent opioid use. Okay. 7 years, about 700 patients, a lot of NIH money. We needed something better. And so what we decided to do is to extend CHOIR into the perioperative environment. Coinciding with this is an effort from the American Academy of Pain Medicine. I was a past president, Dan is our august current president of the Academy, and one of the missions is to develop an acute pain electronic data capture system. And so we all decided to come together and work together. We had a task force come together in Palo Alto, and what we realized is that there's really three components of what we want to capture in the perioperative period. You want to get people before surgery, this baseline period here. You want to get people during the immediate perioperative period, where you want high-frequency data sampling. And then finally, you want to get them postoperatively, where the sampling is not as frequent. Turns out that the first and the third are actually very easy to get using CHOIR, because this is just a clinic visit. In this, we can just send out the automatic email reminders that we're already doing. We're still developing all of this. This is still ongoing, and this is going to require some restructuring, but I'm confident we can get there. So I'm just going to show you a little bit about how we get into developing this in the pre-op clinic. This is a swim lane chart of how we approach things from an operational standpoint, how we think about all of these pieces coming together, where we're identifying patients in the preoperative period in these different periods of time, pre-op, the operative, and post-op. These are the different components and where they all fit in, where we're ultimately leading to this, which is risk and treatment stratification and giving targeted interventions. So we did all of this. We brought the task force together in Palo Alto. A lot of smart people sat down and decided how this was going to be done. We put together a data dictionary and ontology. I went into the pre-op clinic and we put it in there, and I'll tell you, I failed miserably. I was kicked out so fast, it would make your head spin, because I broke rule number one. The rule that I always give everyone for putting CHOIR and bringing systems into another environment, which is get your stakeholders involved, get the staff engaged early. And instead, I failed to do that because I took advantage of all these incredibly gifted, smart people that came to visit us, and we thought we knew what we were doing. And because I went in with this survey and CHOIR, and they said, what the hell is this? This doesn't have any of the information we want. Why are you collecting all this information on emotional distress and catastrophizing? That hasn't, the NPs were just in a fit. So I broke the rule by not getting buy-in from all the people. So we went back, we regrouped, we got together with these folks, and put it together, and I was kicked out again. This time I wasn't kicked out as violently. So we went back and we tried again, and the third time was the charm. We went back in and we really got everything that they wanted, and this is what the current pre-anesthetic questionnaire is. We ended up tailoring it to their specific needs. I actually pulled out a lot of the questionnaires that we all thought were very important, because I decided to buy time and get the early wins, and then we'll build incrementally. So this is the current survey as determined by the Stanford pre-op clinic. Another clinic may choose something different. What we do is get all of the type of pre-operative assessments people want, and we're still getting a number of the patient-reported outcomes from PROMISE using the computer-adaptive testing versions of it. We've now, in the last couple of months that we've been rolled out, we've got about 2,000 unique patients. We see about 50 to 70 patients a day. They're loving it in the clinic. So it's working out well. We're now capturing patients longitudinally, 1, 2, 3, 4, 12, and 24 weeks. We give them an automated email survey. They're running in iPads, Androids, and Chrome notebooks. The average time to collect it is about 12 minutes, which is, we think, pretty reasonable. It's actually, we think, less time than when they were doing the paper and pencil. We have about a 90% survey completion, about 40% complete before coming to the clinic. So the staff like that because it's less time for them. That's my 2-minute warning. These are just data that came so hot off the press that it's still burning my skin, because literally I just got this 15 minutes ago. I asked Ming, who's our biostatistician, to pull the data from the first 2,000. What do you make from this? The fact is, you see 50 is where the t-statistic is a mean for the U.S. population, and 10 is a standard deviation. These are the people in the clinic, and what you find is that our patients in the clinic are depressed, anxious, fatigued, they've got sleep disturbances. The people coming in for surgery are, quite frankly, right at the mean of the U.S. population. So they're representing the average person. This one I thought was a little bit more interesting. Again, this came in 15 minutes ago. This is a log rank of frequency distribution of opioids on a daily basis. And what you find here is the vast majority of our patients are using well under 500 milligram equivalents per day in opioids. But what we have is that there are a small group of people out here that are using thousands and thousands of milligrams during their hospitalization. Let me close out and give my thanks to Mike Kent, who's leading the effort on the acute pain SIG. He's leading the effort on what I'm referring to as what we're deilifying. Deilifying the promise. Promise has a window of 7 days. We're turning it into a one-day version so that we can capture it for acute pain. And he's been an incredible leader on that. He wishes he could be here, but the military won't let him go. The present and future, we've been disseminating this to other sites. As I mentioned, at the Medical College in Wisconsin, where Rob has been doing a great job in leading that effort, as well as other sites nationally. It's going into Israel. We're talking with Canada and hoping to work with them, as well as others. We're working on developing an aggregated data repository. We're collecting genetic information. We're building in the risk and treatment stratification models for this, recommending referrals to pain medicine, psychology, et cetera, targeted educational therapies such as Dr. Darnell's, the daily perioperative sampling. We're finishing up the PROMISE deilifying effort, and we're giving this all away for free. We have a choir meeting at the ISP on Wednesday, September 28th, between 12:30 and 2. Come and visit. We're providing drinks and food. We'll talk about what we've been at. And thank you.
Thank you for the Christmas presentation of such an elaborate talk.